Hello, everybody, and welcome to Cause and Effect, a show about vetes. This is the second part of the fifth episode of the fourth season. We've come a long way. Anyhow, if you missed the first part, I suggest that you watch it before watching this part. We are talking about cross-table ousting, and now we're going to show three examples of decks that are good at cross-table ousting. So, Adam, would you like to bring out the first deck?
Yes, I will.
Cable.
Okay, well, obviously, the deck is just like the deck archetype. This is an example of the deck archetype. This is one of the ones we talked about, I think, in one previous episode.
Yes. Anxiety were visiting us.
Right, yeah. It's one of the Hue decks. One of the iterations of the Cryptic Mission deck. This one is without Cryptic Mission, but I still think it has a lot of strength as a cross-table or back ousting deck.
Okay, why? How?
Well, this one, the cross-table ousting you can do with this one relies heavily on reaction cards, like deflections and delayings.
Okay.
And also direct intervention, mostly for other players' deflections or delayings. So, if you have the resources spare and you feel like, okay, all the other players are kind of fine, deflecting back to another player is actually really, really efficient way of ousting or cross-table ousting someone. And of course, I don't, you have a lot of deflections in this deck. You kind of
a ridiculous amount, and especially since you have all this Hortonichidus Magical Smith going on.
Yeah.
But also, it doesn't only have deflections. It actually has, as I said, the direct intervention can cross table oust someone efficiently in a lot of situations. But where is it? Misdirection, Society of Leopold. Or cards that, for instance, can do it, and also the Blood Denial allies, Gregory Winters, Ocean, Youngbloods, and Karnas the Imp, are all actions which can distract someone or outright oust someone if you do it. So, say, if they have a bouncer, put that guy in torpor, they're dead.
But do you actually like rely on other people's aggression to be able to cross-table oust by using the deflections, or can you do? Is it only the allies that can like do actions from your own self to cross-table oust?
I guess it kind of relies on that. Yes, I would agree with that assessment.
Okay, so when would you cross-table oust with this deck? Why? Who would you do it to?
Someone who has the potential of playing Anarchist Uprising and or Sil Empowerment should be, and for real, you should have that constantly in your mind. Like, never forget about Sil Empowerment and Anarchist Uprising, because for these kinds of decks it's horrible. You could easily get 10 pool damage cross table by a single copy of that card. And yeah, so you should have that in mind. And know that they will be hogging them for the perfect opportunity and then do preferably both of them each turn, so you need two deflections to actually manage to get around that.
Two delaying tactics. No, one delaying tactic.
Two, because Unseen Empowerment and Anarchist Uprising, they are two different cards, and if they have both in their hand and they wait until the mid-game, you're kind of screwed.
Adam, do you have any other arch enemies with this deck?
Well, anyone who you can't control. If someone has a lot of blood, you can't do the blood control thing. And if someone has stealth, your allies won't be able to do much.
Entrancement is a problem.
Yeah, because that can turn the... Since this deck relies a lot on having the control of the table, it's like, now I have my setup, now I win. It's, you want to reach that point.
Yeah.
And anyone who can at certain points or continually overpower you in any area is anyone who has to go.
Okay.
So yeah, the stealth, if they draw enough stealth cards, they're just gonna oust you or what have you. So it's like the power decks, the ones who can do a lot of stuff fast. Orspec's Weenie would be an example of this as well. If you can do that cross table, if you see sense weakness, DI a bounce.
Sweep the leg.
If you bounce back to them and DI a bounce for them,
yeah,
it might for be them. For them, all them.
A favor.
Yeah, here you go. That might be like, okay, now you're done for, because they didn't have three bounces, they only had two. So stuff like that would be good to do, because they just like they're almost impervious to the control that this deck relies on to win. Do you think that explains? Am I coming across as understandable here?
Yeah, kind of understandable.
So then I have this question for you, and hold on tight now. So what if everybody on the table plays really strong decks? Are you screwed then, or how do you manage?
I think at that point you don't cross table oust. At that point you try to build up your own strength, so your relative strength to all the other players is as high as possible.
Yeah.
That's one of the situations where you don't want to cross table oust, when everyone is kind of equal.
I see. Yeah, okay.
But it's basically kind of a indirect cross table ousting, using the resources that other people provide to fuck them up, so to say.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah. You kind of slow yourself down a bit, relax for a few resources, for a few actions, for you pull,
yeah.
And do something cross table to slow someone else down more than you slow yourself down.
Isak, you have a more direct deck that you picked out to be your cross table oust deck.
Yes. This is a deck, Erika Purge Mind Rape deck, which Erik Torstensson have built the foundation, and most of it I just had some amendments, added some amendments to it.
We played this. Before we start?
Yes.
Adam, would you cross table oust this deck with your deck if you saw it on the table?
No.
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 Okay. Why?
Well, this deck is. It's really good against high cap vampires.
Okay.
If you mind rape or burn someone with Beltmar Purge, it's just one of your guys, so you're kind of fine.
No, don't mind rape Brook. Don't do it.
Okay, I'm sorry. Isak, go on.
I played this deck EC Day 2 last year in Warsaw, and I played this in the Swedish Nationals last year. The basic idea is play mind rape. Play Purge, Freak Drive in between, bleed every single turn with Arika and Gratiano. And the obvious cross table ousting options here is either the very direct mind rape on someone's cross table guy, take it, do a backdoor, and then it's dead. Or you use your purges. Because with the purge, very rarely a player only have one vampire, and then you're left with no options. But most of the times, players have that one vampire that they really don't want to get Peltimore purged. And they have one or two guys that's, it's not cool, but it's okay. So when you're in that position, since you have Gratiano or Guido Luciano in play, you have the option of really screwing them over or just slightly screw them over. And in that choice, you have the... It's a very passive cross-table oust, in the sense we talked about, I don't waste any resource. I use the purge to screw my prey and my predator over. And the ones cross-table, they're just a benefit with the card. So you have this, what we talked about, just...
Collateral damage.
Yeah, but that part you talked about, letting someone oust or letting someone die, you in a lot of ways you have that option in this deck built in. It doesn't cost you anything to just, oh, you have EC, oh, or you have Alexandra. Why don't Alexandra go to Torpor?
Okay.
So it's like kind of leveling the playing field. You choose this guy's strong vampire and this one's weak vampire, and then it ends up in your benefit.
Or you can, in a, this one card turn the tables, but this is more the basic deck idea. You can turn the tables extremely. You could go for a everybody got 100 strength, absolute strength situation where you got 400, the other one's got 50.
Yeah. It's a really strong card.
Yeah, but the most obvious cross-table option you have here is Mind Rape, Abactor Banishment, and to some extent, Reigns of Power.
Yeah.
Reigns of Power is very much so unpredictable, but it's a high damage vote. It's one of the highest damage votes you can play in the game.
It's just like a parenthesis. In my head, it's always 6 damage because I'm always thinking I'm playing it with lots.
you should explore other inner circles.
Well, I think you make a really good point about the distinction between the two options for cross table ousting here. It's the ones that cost you and the ones that don't cost you.
Yeah.
So, like playing Reigns of Power at a certain point in time, either before a banishment or after a banishment, or before a mind rape or after a mind rape. When you take their vampire, of course.
Yeah.
If you do that before or after, it changes how much damage or pool someone gains a lot. So the Reigns of Power and the Ancient Influence and the Political Stranglehold, they're kind of, and the Baltimore Purge are kind of like passive. You're gonna play them anyway. You just choose when to play them and how you play them. And it ends up being beneficial to you, and you might cross it out someone.
Yeah.
But it doesn't cost much. But the Mind Rape and the Backdoor costs you, because then you need to play the Mind Rape and you need to play the Backdoor, which you might have wanted to use against something else.
Yeah.
But the ones that are passive, the ones that you get for free per se, that's like really strong, I think.
Mm. And I think that both of these decks that you have presented have like, they're both control decks, and they have the option to be able to cross table out without actually using a lot of your own resources that are supposed to go to ousting your prey, if I'm correct.
This deck more so than the Cryptic Mission deck, but but I think that's actually one of the core things if you are to define what a control deck in Vitas is. That is that deck has the ability to cross table oust and to control minions and control other people's actions. To be able to cross table oust is to be able to control.
Yeah.
No cross table oust, no control. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so which deck would you consider cross table? Do you need to cross table oust with this deck, Adam?
Sorry, take that again.
Yeah, which deck are the most threats? If you're playing this deck, which deck? Which other decks do you have to cross table oust?
I guess it's the ones that can do a lot of damage in a short amount of time. This deck doesn't have a lot of bloat and it doesn't have any reactions. So you really can't end up in a situation where your predator gets a turn with 2 superior dominate minions. If they get to do that even once, you're probably dead. So it's like you need to preempt. You can't let your predator, your ground predator, oust with a lot of minions, and you can't get into the duel with someone who has a lot of dominate minions or presence minions. So I think it's the power bleed decks that are the biggest problem.
Okay.
The other ones you get some time at least to try to work it out. The power bleed decks you need to do it beforehand. You can't react to a power bleed deck.
Yeah, and the other part is if you face something like Nana Rush deck or T.O. Beast Rush deck, like high cap rush decks that do a lot of damage with one single rush.
Anarch Revolt is kind of bothersome.
Anarch Revolt.
Yeah.
Might be a problem, but yeah.
Since it's not an action, it does damage to you no matter what you do, and you can't consider him Anarch.
Yeah, you can go Anarch. You have Guido Luciano and Cameron, and there are 3 in total. So you might be able to end up go Anarch. It depends on your draw, of course. But 75% chance to have one of those, or 74 point something, whatever. Those are the two biggest threats. Probably the biggest threat of all is like a Govern chain deck that starts at cap 7 and bleeds for shitloads.
So we're basically talking about a Kassid deck.
Kaisid, Stickman, Vignes, Karna, Basic La Sombra Nocturne deck.
Yeah, a lot of decks.
Law firms, those are problematic.
Yeah.
But also, since you play Mind Rape, those are also the decks which you can have the most benefit from. Since after Mind Rape, you can get around where you can push, ditch out up to 25 something damage. Now, anyways, no hardcore analysis of this deck. From a cross table point of view, that's what you want to do with that.
Yeah. Okay.
More thing that I should stress again was Adam said this deck is specialized in a high cap meta.
Yeah.
Keep that in mind.
So I have a little bit more straightforward, maybe easy, cross-table ousting deck that might not be as good because you actually spend a lot of your resources that are supposed to oust preys. And that's a Lutzo Mata deck, which we got here. And it's of course basically just doing lots of things. He can vote a lot cross-table and you get the benefit of the Kindred Spirits bleed, which also can, it's the only card that can bleed cross table, so it's easy to manage, it's easy to do even if you're not an experienced player. That maybe Baltimore Purge can be quite hard to master. This is kind of easy to play because you know what you're doing, but as I said, it costs a little bit more resources from your own forward path. I don't know, Adam?
It has the power to outright cross-table out someone, and that's kind of unique. Not a lot of decks can actually do the final damage themselves. Most of the decks only have the option of
lowering strength.
But this one can actually do the damage itself, so that's kind of unique. And it has both the bleed and the vote, which is very unique.
Yeah.
And Power Shift.
So it has
kind. They're kind of the basic cross table oust card. You have paired shift, so you can even do the cross table saving if that's needed. You have the Kindred Spirits, and you have the Petra Resonance.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Which is kind of weird, but but after most people got the setup, you get a mindset. What's their crypt span? Oh, this guy plays between 2 and 7, and that guy plays between that and that, and you know. Yourself plays between 10 and 11. So which one is most likely to gain pool? Oh, what's me? And which one is the most likely to lose pool? Is one of those two guys? I'm fine with them being cross-table ousted. Play Petra Resonance.
And I think if you make that group up someone, the 10 and 11 cap decks are the ones that are kind of fine for lots of moda Petra Resonance deck.
Yeah.
So if you end up in a situation where you can't hurt them that much, it's fine, because most of the time these decks are fine for you. But it's the smaller cap decks, the ones that you might end up stealing from, that's the ones that are the threat for you. So most of the time, even if it's kind of luck-based, most of the time the luck is the way you want it.
Okay. So, Adam touched the subject, but Isak, what are the decks that you need to cross-table out when you're playing this deck?
I would go very heavily on the same decks that we talked about earlier. Either the ones who can do one single rush that like basically rips a vampire apart. Should be very, very worried about what time they start to like want to sniff you out and go kill you. And the mid-cap govern chain decks that can ditch out so much damage.
Because I was thinking about other vault decks, but...
That's also, as we talked about earlier, the when you have that one banishment, now I see this deck doesn't have any banishments, that should be fixed, and you want to do that snipe. You use the telepathic vault counting and a banishment, and you try to snipe, banish someone in order to gain the vault lock.
Okay. So I think that's kind of a straightforward with this deck.
The vote is kind of... It's funny because it's kind of fine as well.
Yeah, because you have Lutz.
Yeah. If someone else votes something, at least you benefit something from it, and you have enough bleed to bleed yourself.
Yeah.
So, And it also might not work in the long term. That player might die at some point, but if you, like, at certain times during the game, if you don't have vote lock, it's fine, because you can bleed and you still get something out of it.
Yeah, and of course, it's, you make damage on your prey, even if you vote for a cross-table oust. So, Lutz is awesome.
Yes.
As we say in Sweden, Lutz is awesome. Okay, so we each picked out a deck that we thought were good for cross-table ousting, but none of us chose a rush deck, because I would kind of figure that making a cross-table rush is a good way to ousting someone. Why didn't we do that, Ethan?
Because when at the early to mid-game, say 4 or 5 players on the table, the rush deck don't really have it. Basically, the rush deck don't have enough rushes to survive in like 99 cases out of 100. So you never basically have a rush to rush cross-table. When you start having the ability to control the table, that's when you're down to the 3-player table. Yeah. So that's when you start to really win with a rushing deck.
And you're still, when you're the 3-player game, you're still rushing your prey and your predator. So.
Yeah. You are, because you're only 3 players. So that's why the rush deck should be very, very, very of these kinds of decks. This Punmada Lutzenanz deck, or the Arika Purge deck. That category of decks, because they really want to kill the rush deck before they end up in the 3-player games, or maybe even the 4-player games.
Yeah,
I think it's a good point. The rush decks, they are the ones who want to. Well, they are the ones who are going to be ousted cross table. They are the target most of the time. They're not the ones who cross table oust themselves. Because if a rush deck gets into the situation where he actually has rushes spare, he's kind of winning the game.
Yeah.
For real.
It's kind of like, the rush deck wants to get into the 3-player situation as fast as possible because it doesn't have the resources to cross-table out someone.
Yeah.
It needs to have a direct impact when they rush someone. It can't be indirect because you don't have time for that as a rush deck. If you have time for that, you're probably already winning.
Yeah.
Okay, any final thoughts about cross-table ousting, Adam?
Make sure you can stand the ramifications. Realize that if you cross-table oust someone, that player's predator might become the new threat. Can you deal with that threat in that case? Maybe not. So try to think the whole thing through before you do it. It can end up really badly if you don't.
It's kind of like back ousting. If you're just getting a stronger predator, then it's probably not worth doing it.
Yeah.
Isak?
Because we three from Örebro, Sweden, we come from a meta where we have done a lot of cross-table ousting and back ousting. So we've seen several instances where it's backfired as like shit hits the fans, going so bad with cross-table ousting. And also the eventual retribution of that cross-table ousting. So you should really, as Adam said, think of the ramifications, what might this lead to, who actually wins the most of this, because every single oust ends up making that the ousted player's predator being very much getting a lot stronger.
Yeah.
You need to weight that.
It's hard to do. I think this is like the hardest skill, is to actually realize someone's strength.
Yeah.
Make an accurate analysis of a game on the fly by yourself with just the knowledge that you've gotten. It's really, really hard. And if you do that analysis wrong, your decisions will be wrong.
Yeah.
So it's not only really hard, it's also crucial.
Yeah. Before we sum it up or leave it for this time, we have a little bit to thinking about cross table ousting is a way to maximize VP, so it's like a funny or taboo way of handling your table. Another taboo way of handling your table, as we talked about earlier, is self ousting. Adam, do you have any?
Yeah, self-ousting is a part of the game, and it's allowed in some cases, so it needs to be thought about. But I think self-ousting is never game technically beneficial. It's only beneficial in a like social threat deal-breaking kind of way. As Isaac talked about earlier, there's always the possibility for nerd rage benediction, or what you want to call it. And one way of nerd rage benediction is the self-oust. And it's one of these things that you gotta bear in mind. If you are like really dominating the table and dominating the table talk and doing lots of stuff to other players that they don't like, things might not go the way you planned it, might not go the way that's the reasonable way, because someone might self-oust just to spite you. And yeah, it happens. And if they're in a loose situation, they're allowed to do it, and it can change the game a lot. So thinking about it is, in some cases, really beneficial.
And you really end up here in a, like, almost psychology class when you start to think about it. What makes a person rage so much that... but for real, this is very interesting and very important to understand a game. What makes a people rage so much that it wants to self-oust? There's probably a damaged self-esteem or a sense of I need control of my situation, the game. I need to feel that I do something in this game. So if you end up in a situation where you in your entire body feels that it's as much point of being here as I don't know anything really pointless.
Unsharpened pencil.
Yeah,
that's a horrible analogy.
Go ahead.
I think you could do better. I'm so, cutting in stone.
Yeah. So if you see that me doing this towards this person, and I don't want that person ousted by doing X, Y, or Z or whatever train of actions I'm initiating, it makes up that player ending up in this very, very talked about lost position. Yeah. If a player gets to a lost position, most people have a, I don't know what to put it, but a sense of pride or something, some sort of morals that drives them to, I need to stick out in a game, it's taboo to self-out. But in some situations, with some people, there's like, fuck this shit, I'm out of here.
I just want to mess with this guy's game.
Yeah.
Because this guy ruined it for me, so here you go, this is it.
Yeah.
That's I am pro self-ousting under the right circumstances, of course. When it's allowed by the rules, and then I'm really pro self-ousting. I believe like if someone had just fucked up my game, I should be able to fuck him up by self-ousting, or I could also choose not to self-oust and being a pool buffer to just fuck up that person's game that enabled me to play.
And I think a lot of people think like this, so it's important to keep in mind.
Yeah,
my point here is I agree with your sentiment, or rather I agree with you totally. But the thing is, if you're feeling sad or angry or mistreated or whatever feelings inside,
angry.
I don't think that feeling applies. If you have that particular emotion in your body, you might end up not assessing the situation incorrectly. Yeah. You make the wrong analysis of the game.
Yeah.
So you might self-oust or do something rash that damaged your game, and you actually lose the opportunity of a VP or a game win or something like that.
Yeah.
And then, so that's my biggest problem with self-ousting is I've done it once or twice, and in hindsight, like, that wasn't really necessary. I got nothing. I had a slim chance of continuing. And even more so, I see people like self-ousting and rage. It's like, but when you do this, dead people don't get VPs.
Yeah, you don't want to. If you actually have a 1% chance of winning, you don't want to decrease that to zero. Mm. That's bad play. Like, straight up bad play, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I totally agree. It's that, but some people's like, oh fuck it, if it's less than 10% chance of me actually getting any, no point in sitting here. Really bad play. Actually.
I would say like the only bad situation to self-oust is when you're actually helping the one who's made you come to that. You have to self-oust.
If I have zero minions and four pool,
yeah,
and I feel like it's my predator's fault, I'm gonna do one choice, and if I feel like it's my prey fault, I'm gonna do another thing.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's self-oust or just take your pause my turn. Yeah, but something that's really interesting with the self-ousting part is if you say you let your prey live because you don't want to make it possible for your ground prey to block you, for instance, and he doesn't have any minions in the uncontrolled region, you don't put him at one pool so he can self-oust by pay one to see one. You might want to put him at two pool so he can't self-oust. It's actually not possible for him. So that's something that's good to think about, because if they actually can't self-oust, then that's out of your head. You don't need to think about that.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, well, it's a hard decision to make.
And there's also a lot of opinions here. It's not like actually quantifiable what's the right way to do it.
No, of course.
What I can say in contradiction that is quantifiable is that when you're self-ousted, there's no way in hell you get more VPs. And you should always have that in the back of your head.
Yeah. But it's also the...
But you can force a table split.
Yeah, in some situations.
Like that. And that can actually be quite a lot.
Yeah, but you're not getting any more VPs.
Yeah. Okay, we will let that end our discussion on self-house. We might pick it up some other time.
Yeah, there's a lot of things written about this as well on the Beacon forums, if someone wants to.
No one wants to.
Oh, that'd be so crazy. Okay, so anyway, that's it for this time. Thanks everyone for watching, and remember, if you have any thoughts, comments, or ideas, you can post them on our Facebook page or send an email to the address below. Visit causeampersandeffect@gmail.com. Remember to like us on Facebook and subscribe to our YouTube account. We will post a thread on beacon.net after when we break up, where you can continue the discussion. So thanks a lot for watching, and have a good week.
Goodbye.
Bye.